Good day to you. Welcome back. Right now I'm going to speak to you about wholeness. And I know some of you say, I've heard that before, I know all about it, but I want to give you a very quick, different perspective. I think it's a different perspective. There's a story in the New Testament. It is in the book of Mark. Chapter 5, which is one of my favorite stories, the woman with the issue of blood. But I'm going to read to you from Matthew chapter 9. It's the same story from Matthew chapter 9, and it says here, you know, the woman with the issue of blood, just to set a very quick backdrop. She had been sick for 12 years. She had spent all her money. She was disillusioned, discouraged. And then when she heard that Jesus was coming to town, she said, if only I can touch the hem of his garment. And she pushed through the crowds and she did that. And she got her healing. But in Matthew chapter 9, when she does that and Jesus senses the power leaving her, he says to her, it says, but Jesus turned around and when he saw her, he said, be of good cheer. In other words, take courage, have courage. Daughter, and that's a whole other message. He spoke identity over her. Your faith has made you well. And the woman was made well from that hour. But in the old King James, in the King James version, it says, your faith has made you whole. Then, you know, at that moment, we have Jairus who's standing there because Jairus had come to fetch Jesus, to take him back to his house because his 12-year-old daughter was sick. And then the report came that his daughter had died. And Jesus stopped and he looked at Jairus and he said, do not fear, only believe. Because Jesus knew the end of the story. And so I always believe in there, I just want to add this, I always believe that when those two stories are put together, because Jairus needs a huge miracle now because he's at the point where he's received this news that his daughter has died, and he thought that Jesus was coming back with him to lay hands on her and she would receive her healing. But the point is, he saw a miracle happen. Jairus saw a miracle happen right in front of his eyes. So it's like he was set up to choose, am I going to fear because I've heard what the people from my house say? It's the end of the story. My daughter has died. Or am I going to do what Jesus said? Don't fear, only believe, because he had seen the miracle. That's very important. So in Matthew chapter 9, verse 23, it says this. When Jesus came into the ruler's house and saw the flute players and the noisy crowd wailing, he said to them, make room for the girl is not dead, but sleeping. Now, remember, the girl had died in the natural. The report came, don't bother the teacher anymore, your little girl has died. She was dead. But Jesus saw beyond that, and he said, she's not dead, she's sleeping. And they ridiculed him. But when the crowd was put outside, he went in and took her by the hand, and the girl arose. And sorry. And the report of this went out into all that land. Of course, news is going to get spread. Now, I want to say to you, that story, those two stories, the woman with the issue who was made whole and the little girl who was raised from the dead, makes me think of our lives before we got saved and what happened when we got saved. We were sleeping before we turned to Christ. We were darkness. We weren't just in darkness. And then Jesus came and we acknowledged him as Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. And something happened in our lives, and we forget about this when we walk this Christian walk and we go to church and we do our tithing and we pray, we read our Bible. We forget the power that has actually been given to us, what happened in our lives through salvation. So, and this is important when we're talking about getting ready for revival. This was the beginning of revival in your life. This was where you were resurrected. So when Jesus said to the woman with the issue of blood, be of good cheer, be courageous, because your faith has made you whole. This is what it means. It's the word sozo, S-O-Z-O. And a lot of you know the sozo program where you go for healing of past issues, and we allow the Spirit of God to speak about areas in our lives that we need to be set free in. And this is what sozo means. This is what Jesus was saying to the woman with the issue of blood. It means, be of good cheer, because you've just been sozoed to save, to deliver or protect, to heal. And all we do is we look at that woman and we thought she got healed. Jesus said, you healed. But it was so much more than that. Her whole life would have changed from that point in time. To save, to deliver, to protect, to preserve. If you ever worry about what's going to happen with you as the world gets darker, you've been sozoed. You are put aside to be preserved. To do well, that's another good one. And to make whole, obviously. But this is what it means in, and that was the Strong's definition, I think. Yes. This is what it means in another definition. To save, to keep safe and sound, to rescue from danger or destruction. This is our inheritance. This is what we walk in. To rescue from danger or inheritance. To rescue from injury or peril. To save a suffering one from perishing. One suffering from disease. To make well, heal, restore to health. These are all the benefits of turning to Jesus. To preserve one who is in danger of destruction, and to save or rescue, to save in the technical biblical sense. Okay, all of those things. And here's a scripture, Ephesians chapter 2 from verse 1. It says, now think of that little girl who the report came she had died. This is Ephesians chapter 2. And you he made alive who were dead in trespasses and sins. We were dead. In which you once walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit who now works in the sons of disobedience, among whom also we all once conducted ourselves in the lusts of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature children of wrath just as the others. But God, who is rich in mercy because of his great love with which he loved us. It's like Jesus. He didn't have to go back with Jairus. He could have looked at him and said, you don't have enough faith. It's your miracle is past its sell by date. You may as well give up now and just go home. But he didn't. He said, don't fear, only believe. He gave him a choice. It's like the choice we have to turn to Jesus or to live our own lives in darkness. And so, but the rich mercy of God pursued us. Because of his great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in trespasses. You know, some people think that we're too far gone for God to do anything. Even when believers think this, I made too many mistakes, I did this, God, I'm too far gone. I'll just get by in this life. No, revival is, you are earmarked for revival. But God, who is rich in mercy, then says, even when we were dead in trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved, and raised us up together, and made us sit together in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, that in the ages to come he might show the exceeding riches of his grace and of his grace in his kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith. And that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not of works, lest anyone should boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. Colossians 2:6 says this, as you therefore have received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk in him, rooted and built up in him and established in the faith, as you have been taught, abounding in it with thanksgiving. And then it goes on and it says, for in him dwells all the fullness of the Godhead bodily, and you are complete in him. Isn't that amazing? In Christ, you are complete. You are perfected. You are everything he needs. You are complete in him who is the head of all principality and power. Buried with him in baptism. You were also raised with him through faith in the working of God who raised him from the dead. These are powerful scriptures that we forget in the midst of our challenges. We forget we have been raised. We're seated in heavenly places. And then it says here, and you being dead in your trespasses and the uncircumcision of your flesh, he has made alive together with him, having forgiven you all trespasses, having wiped out the handwriting of requirements that was against us, which was contrary to us, and he has taken it out of the way, having nailed it to the cross, having disarmed principalities and powers, he made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them in it. This is our inheritance. Jesus made a public spectacle of the enemy. We walk in this freedom, in this resurrection life that belongs to us, that is part of us. When we turn to Christ, we entered into a life of being saved, being rescued, being free, our inheritance. And then I want to end with this. Ephesians 5 verse 8 says this. For you were once darkness, past tense. We weren't in darkness, we were darkness. We thought we had it all together. We thought we could make a plan and get by. But now you are light in the Lord. You're not just in the light, you are light in Him. Walk as children of light. So I want you to be encouraged with that this morning, that there's so much more to your salvation, your life today, than just getting by. If you will just go back, you remember how you felt when you first turned to Jesus and everything felt new and everything felt possible. And then over time, things just begin to weigh us down and we get disappointed and we think we don't have enough faith and all of these things that go on in our lives. But if we remember that we were once like that woman with the issue of blood, surrounded by discouragement, hopelessness, no way out. And as when she got to touch the hem of the garment of Jesus, he said to her, be of good cheer, your faith has made you whole. You've been delivered, you've been rescued. Now go and walk in the identity as a daughter of the King. You now have an inheritance, and I'm saying this to you today. And we were like that little girl, the daughter of Jairus, who everybody said, no, there's no hope for you. You know, you're too far gone. And Jesus came along, picked you up and said, arise, little girl. I say to you, arise. And so now arise into this identity that you have in Christ. Arise into this place where you're out of darkness now. And darkness has no place in your life. Darkness has been made a public spectacle by Jesus. So walk in that today. Be encouraged with that today.